Thank you very much for that very kind and generous introduction. I cannot begin to tell you how honored I am to have been invited to address you. I think about our profession today and where it is, and I think back to when I started as a law student. We have today about 1.2, 1.3 million lawyers in the United States. About 850,000 of us actually practice law. The others who have graduated from law school, passed the bar, are using their degrees to do so many other different kinds of things. One does not even think about as a possibility when you're sitting where you are today. In particular, I can't begin to share with you the sense of feeling that I have for what Benjamin Mitchell has done to bring all of you together. Out of that 1.2, 1.3 million licensed lawyers in the United States, about 10.4% of us are lawyers of color. That's African American, Asian, Hispanic, etc. We are grossly underrepresented. You cannot imagine how much each and every one of you are needed. Should you go to law school, graduate and pass the bar, and get involved in our profession. I started night school back in 1966 at the Detroit College of Law. At the time I was teaching learning disabled students in Detroit. Much like the great dean that just spoke to you from Boston College, this was never offered to us. What Evangeline had done in terms of bringing you here and bringing some of the most dynamic, outstanding, powerful speaking people who have different backgrounds to share with you why it's so important for you to go to law school. You just can't imagine. This program, if it had been available to me before I started school, law school, I know I would have had a great foundation of knowledge that would have given me a distinct advantage. I therefore salute each and every one of you, and I thank you for considering law as a profession, but also showing your early wisdom by attending this conference and lawfare. When I graduated from law school, the American Bar Association had no standards that required any law school to have what was called an affirmative action program to reach out and encourage and try to bring in law students of color. We had very, very few law professors of color, unless you went to a historically black college or university. Right here at Harvard's Law School, Derek Bell, well-known, well-respected, tenured law professor, walked away from Harvard's Law School because he felt that diversity was not being acted upon here. There are a lot of things that have occurred since I started law school and graduated. During my legal career, I've served on the American Bar Association's Law School Accreditation Committee and on the section of legal education and admission to the bar. I can tell you without any reservation that your best friend, for those of you who have not started law school yet, and if you are sitting next to or as you talk to people who are in law school, I think they will confirm that your best friend in the first year of law school is Black's Law Dictionary. Because there's nothing in an undergraduate degree, at least I've found, that prepares you for law school. Using different terms and meanings, and you are trying to understand what it's all about. And so I will tell you that, without any reservation, it was mentioned about grades. Your first year grades in law school will determine in large measure your course of what you will likely do or start doing when you finish law school. Those with the best grades, I think the dean mentioned the top 10%, will have more options when they graduate from law school. I will also tell you that if you're in that top 10% at whatever law school you go to, you will be able to do a lot of things that right now you don't even know that happen to be available. Clerkships. Dean mentioned that she had some clerkships. That was something that was not available to us. We had to fight for it and to make it happen. And right now, the American Bar Association, every mid-year meeting, they have judges who attend, Supreme Court justices from state Supreme Courts, federal judges from around the United States, that are looking to help you think about becoming a judicial law firm. It is something that is just absolutely prestigious and something that will give you a head jump start on most anything that you want to do. And of course, when you start thinking about getting good grades, you hear magnus cum laude. Let me just tell you this. You graduate top 10% of your class. If you become complacent because you think that you live a lie, and you start working, you give me a student who graduates a 2.0, or thank you, Lordy. If that person wants to work and is willing to work hard and be prepared, that person in 5 to 10 years will outshine the person who graduated the top of the class and became complacent. Why? Because they wanted to work at it and they wanted to be the best that they could be. Another subject before I share my personal life with you is that if you need to borrow money to go to law school, please don't borrow any more than you absolutely need, because the money is there for you to be able to borrow, and you can use it. But if a law school has a dorm for law students, I'd urge you to live in the dorm and not go look for some condominium high-rise that's got an exercise room and a pool that you can enjoy, etc. Use the money wisely. Why? Because you're going to have to pay it back. And if you use it wisely, it will help you a great deal. For those of you who graduate from law school, you pass the bar, there are 4 or 5 major organizations that have been initiated over time. And their sole purpose is to help each and every one of you, if you want to aspire to work in corporate America or be hired by a large law firm. And they're there to help you. Those organizations were started because there was no help before they really got actively involved. I helped start one of them, the American Bar Association, and several others have spun off. They're there to help you, and they want to give you every opportunity to succeed. Not everybody wants to go to a law firm, a large law firm. Some want to be able to get into legal services. Some wanted to be a sole practitioner. Some may have been touched by something that occurred that they saw that they felt was just not fair. It may have been their family, it could have been a friend. And they were moved. They were moved to want to be a lawyer that can help others. There's nothing like being a lawyer and take advantage of what the dean talked about. When I was in law school, we didn't have kind of classes where you could go in and you're there to help veterans or you're there to help somebody who's having a housing problem. Whatever the clinical program happens to be, get involved. You will find more people who you will be able to help. And when you walk out of that class after having helped someone who would not have been able to be serviced without you being there and helping them, and they look you in the eye, whether you win or lose that case, and say, thank you, I appreciate what you have done for me and my family. There's nothing more satisfying than being able to help someone in need. In the time remaining, let me say that if you want to know more about me, I published a book last December. It's called Let the Future Begin. And it was, I had a co-author, Elizabeth Atkins, and you can find it on Amazon or Barnes & Noble. The reason why I wrote the book is because we've got two grandsons. One now is 13, the other is 10. And they were not alive when I was mayor or even on the mission of Supreme Court. So my wife thought it would be valuable for me to share with them through this book what my life was like and what I've tried to accomplish. And the book, I think, will serve as a motivation for young people, especially those who may be growing up and have lived through poverty, to learn that they too can reach the stars, as Dr. Benjamin Lee so aptly described. If there's a person who seeks or wants to become an elected official, there is an achievable roadmap in this book. I was born in Detroit, January 1st, 1942. My dad sent my mother and I was still in our womb, to Detroit because in Cassopolis, population about 1,200, we did not have a hospital. My dad did not have a car. My dad had a third grade education, lost his arm just above his left elbow before I was born. My mother had a high school diploma. Cassopolis is about 187 miles from Detroit, Michigan, population about 1,200. When I moved back to Cassopolis, got out of the car and said, Mom, I gotta go to the bathroom. She took me to a little house, looked like a little house. It was an outhouse. We had no running water and we had no bathrooms. The book, by the way, Let the Future Begin, is not about me, it's about the city of Detroit, what we were able to accomplish. My father's family moved from North Carolina to Logan County, Ohio, then to Cassopolis. My mother's family from Tazewell, Virginia to Cassopolis. We were poor and lived below poverty. My dad made $75 every 2 weeks for 6 months of the year and $37.50 for the other 2 weeks of the year, other 6 months of the year. He worked for a gentleman who owned a tool and die shop in South Bend, Indiana. And during those times, especially when he was earning $37.50 a week, he would say, I've got to go down to the Department of Social Services. I didn't have a clue what that meant. I didn't know that he was going down to get a check from welfare so we could make ends meet. I didn't know how poor we were. We didn't have a television. And everybody else in Cassopolis pretty much lived the same way. I started working at the age of 8. My first job was a caddy on the golf course. My parents, we never set foot on a college campus at any time during our life, told me as long as I can remember, son, you are going to go to college. You can be successful. Whatever it is that you want to do, but you've got to get a good education. Therefore, I learned early on that the teachers who taught me in K through 12 were always right. We didn't have a telephone, but if something happened at school, I don't know how they learned before I got home. But I heard about it. Because the teachers were always right and they wanted to make sure I got a good education. I graduated from Western Michigan University after working my way through high school and working my way through college. And I started teaching at Bunch Elementary School in Detroit. And the principal thought I got along so well with the students and with my fellow teachers that, you ought to be a principal. So I said, okay. I enrolled at the University of Michigan and the